subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
13th October last year, that is 13th October 2020, you might recall, or chances are that you must have read the stories already, so you know what I'm talking about. Power supply in Bombay went out, say generally between 10 a.m. and 12 noon. Now, Mumbai is India's financial capital. It's also India's economic capital in many ways. It's a very active city, maximum city as it's called. But this is when the stock market is on and lots of other activities on. And remember, October was also the time when India was facing its peak COVID cases, coronavirus cases. And Mumbai was the worst affected of India's big cities. Its hospitals were chock-a-block, ICUs were chock-a-block. It was short of oxygen beds, etc., etc. It was at that point that power went out for just a couple of hours, and it spread a real scare and panic in Mumbai. Hospitals, of course, were down to emergency supplies to the extent that they could manage. But this was catastrophic. Stock market shut down. All kinds of awful things happened, and then it got okay. At that point, Maharashtra government had said, Maharashtra Power Minister had also said, that it looked like it was sabotage, but that matter was not pursued. I think some investigations were ordered. So as often happens in our system, we tend to move on and we think, okay, something happened, because power keeps going off all the time in our country. Sometimes we have large grid failures also. So what was so special about it? Although there was suspicion of sabotage then. What has now happened is, the new thing now is that the New York Times has come up with a major story under important bylines. These are the bylines of David Sanger, who's a Dada, with Emily Schmall, who's reporting from India, and Nicole Perlroth. Now, this story, and I'll read the headline for you. The story is headlined, China appears to warn India, push too hard and the lights could go out. Now, this story suggests that while in June, Indian and Chinese troops clashed in Galwan, and also tensions were really high in that period, the Chinese were meanwhile bombarding a lot of Indian systems, particularly Indian power systems, electricity systems, with malware that they could activate at any point of time. Now, how do these reporters find this information? They've got it from a company which is a cybersecurity company, and you will see the screenshot of the homepage of that company. Screenshot actually has the report that the company has produced on this cyber attack in India. This company is called Recorded Future. It's based in Somerville, Massachusetts. It's quite a highly reputed company on cybersecurity. And I'm sharing this report with you with the description today. So those of you who are more technologically inclined, or who are nerdy, or who know more than me about technology, which is easy, which means almost all of you, you can read that report in detail. What this report says is that the Chinese hackers, backed by the Chinese state and Chinese security services, they also give a name to these hackers. This group is called Red Echo. So this group called Red Echo targeted Indian systems. Now, further details that have come out later have mentioned another bunch of Indian companies, or actually specific Indian companies that were targeted. So there is Power Systems Corporation Limited. There is NTPC, National Thermal Power Corporation Limited. NTPC's Kudgi Power Plant, I think in Karnataka. Then Southern Regional Load Dispatch Center, Northeastern Regional Load Dispatch Center, Eastern Regional Load Dispatch Center, Delhi State Regional Load Dispatch Center, and Tikri Kalan, that is Mundka on the outskirts of Delhi, substation of Delhi Transmission Company, Delhi Transco, and also Mumbai Port Trust, and also Chidambaranar Port Trust, which means that these were targeting critical infrastructure nodes, particularly those to do with electricity. So what happened in October? Now, nobody is confirming. Even the NYT story is not confirming that was caused by the Chinese hackers, but that is now based on sufficient circumstantial evidence, because in that period, in October, November, December, massive Chinese sort of transmission of malware was seen towards Indian entities. So you put two and two together and you come to that conclusion. Now that, if that is the case, which it looks like is the case, although nobody is willing to say this on the record, because if it is said on the record, it will really foul up the India-China situation, which has just calmed down with the talks between our foreign minister S. Jaishankar and his Chinese counterpart Wang Yi. But if the Chinese did it, which it looks like they did, then this was in the nature of what would be called firing a shot across the bow. So you fire a shot across the bow of a ship that you want to challenge to say that, look, either turn in the direction where I want you to turn, or don't turn in the direction where I don't want you to turn, or the next shot could come and hit your ship. So in that case, the Chinese did that. They showed you a little trailer of what they could do, because they had all this malware sitting in Indian power distribution systems. And they said, if we can do it to your commercial capital for a couple of hours, we can do it to the entire country. We can shut down your banking, etc., etc. So be careful. This was power projection. Now just look at it sort of in strategic terms. In strategic terms, increasingly now it's very tough for countries to fight wars which are old-fashioned wars, which involve a lot of casualties. Because even if you win a war, even if you are overwhelmingly superior to the other side, you still suffer physical casualties. Americans keep on suffering casualties in Afghanistan. Americans kept on suffering casualties in Iraq. Because no matter what you do, the other side also has a weapon. So the old saying comes into being. I mean, you can use this saying for the metaphor for any weapon system, but God created men, Kalashnikov made them equal. So when soldiers face soldiers, they will die. Some will die no matter what your superiority is. And increasingly, countries don't want to take physical damage now, and they don't like losing lives. You see what's happened in China recently. The Chinese admitted to just 4 dead and 1 injured in Galwan. Although all international observers, Indian observers, everybody believes the Chinese casualties were much more. It can't be that no one else was injured. And there's a story that we published yesterday, and I'm sharing it with you in today's description, from by Snehesh Alex Philip, our defense editor, who says that at various points of time during these talks that take place between Chinese and Indian militaries, the number of 4, 9, 14 has been mentioned. But you leave all that aside, because that is not central to the argument. What is central to the argument is that the Chinese admitted to just 4 dead and 1 injured in Galwan. And see the reaction it caused on Chinese social media, on Weibo, the anger. There was so much anger, disappointment, bitterness, as if it was an impossibility that Chinese lives could have been lost in battle. So countries now, this gives you an indication that even a country like China, which has fought big wars in the past, has taken a lot of damage, it now does not have that much appetite to take physical casualties of its soldiers. So when you don't want physical casualties and you have a method like this cyber weapons available, then you use this because it's low cost, it gives you plausible deniability, because you can say, I haven't done it, anybody could have done it, or your electricity system is so bad anyway in India, it keeps crashing, what can I do? It could be sabotage internally, it could be corporate sabotage, anything. So unless you can pinpoint it, it becomes tough, and it's happened in the past. Putin's Russia, for example, had Ukraine's power go out twice, not once, twice. And even recently, Russians infiltrated with their malware lots of American systems. In fact, in the past, Americans had retaliated by putting their own malware into Russian power distribution systems. Now, new reports have come out after Biden administration has taken over that the Americans, that the Chinese have again infiltrated a whole bunch of American government agencies and more than 100 corporations. And Biden administration says it's going to pay back in kind. So what it does is it gives you no physical loss on your side. You don't throw any bombs. You don't have to show any wreckage. You don't have to give any evidence of what happened. But similarly, no evidence comes to you also, which means you can say, I don't know. So this is plausible deniability, and that is what it, apparently the Chinese have shown their capability of doing this to India, that look, push comes to the shove, we will not just call fight you on the line of actual control where soldier to soldier there will be casualties and we know that you can defend, but we can now fight you elsewhere. So what this has done is, the key lesson of this is that today's warfare, today's wars will not be fought on the borders or lines of control or lines of actual control or lines of control as with Pakistan. Today's wars, particularly with big powers, between big powers, that is India and China, will be fought anywhere. So your entire country, the entire internet, in fact, that means the whole world, is your battlefield. You don't just fight at the borders, and your weapons are no longer tanks and guns and submarines and ships and torpedoes and missiles and fighter aircraft and artillery guns. No, they are now malware, artificial intelligence, computers, cyber attacks. So warfare has now moved into the next generation. You want to call it fifth, you can call it the fifth, but it's now gone into a combination of fourth and the fifth, but it has got there. Increasingly, bigger powers will avoid having to fight physical wars, which sent their own body bags home also, because we've seen just admitting to 4 body bags has caused such a furor in China. So this is the big lesson of what has happened. Now, this recorded future report says that the Chinese carried out a coordinated attack on a bunch of load dispatch centers. Now, you know, a country has power supply coming in from everywhere. It's a humongous grid. So at various points of time, depending on where the demand is, where the need is, these load dispatch centers manage the load so that you don't have an outage or shortage of power in one place or too much power or surge in another place. So these are the ones that these coordinated attacks targeted. And again, Recorded Future says that they believe that this was not so much an act of aggression as of deterrence, to show this is what we are capable of. That's what we said, firing a shot across the bow. So Recorded Future notified this to CERT in CERT-IN. That is the Indian agency that looks at computer emergencies. It's called Computer Emergency Response Team. That's why CERT and IN for India. So they were informed, they acknowledged that they had been informed, but after that nothing, no response came from the Indian side. That is what Recorded Future says. Now, Recorded Future has produced all this data, but more data has come out, and some of that maybe makes it look like that we were also not entirely innocent. And the New York Times story says that it's possible that Indian side may have provoked it, because they trace some activity in February of last year, that is February of 2020, when a bunch of Indian hackers, which are reportedly, according to the New York Times, backed by Indian state agencies, they tried to target a bunch of Chinese health infrastructure in Wuhan. In Wuhan, by that time, coronavirus was spreading. Wuhan was the epicenter. There was very little of coronavirus outside of Wuhan. So these reports say that Indian hackers who are connected or backed by Indian security agencies or Indian state agencies tried to target these hospitals and research centers in Wuhan. Now, this is something that was reported by a Chinese cyber security firm called 360 Security Tech. So 360 Security Tech accessed some of this stuff and reported this. Nothing much was made of it, but this is shortly after this, border tensions began to arise. And once border tensions began, then Recorded Future picked up 40,300 hack attempts on Indian entities. And this was also, most of it was picked up by Indian agencies also. And these hack attacks were mostly traced to 2 domain entities registered in Guangdong and Henan in China. Once again, the targets were power plants, power sector, petroleum refinery, and the organization that was supposed to be behind this was then called Feng Shaoqing. My pronunciation is not perfect, but Feng Shaoqing. Then now Maharashtra government has acknowledged that they believe it was sabotage. They still say we can't confirm it was a Chinese sabotage. And that's what the national central authorities also say. So MERC, which is Maharashtra Electricity Regulatory Commission, Central Electricity Authority, Cyber Cell of Maharashtra Government, Maharashtra Police, they are all investigating. So Sanjay Shintre, who's the new SP of Cyber Cell, he spoke to our correspondent, Regina Mahindukulu Surya, who covers tech for us, and he says that they are looking into the details of this. Power Ministry, the Central Power Ministry, has meanwhile said that we noted another attempt more recently in February, but that failed because we found some malware. But they say that POSOCO, POSOCO, which is Power Systems Operational Control Corporation Limited, was not affected. It kept on functioning all right. And then our correspondent, Regina Mahindukulu Surya, also reached out to Lieutenant General Rajesh Pant, who is the head of NCSC, or National Cyber Security Coordinator, who said that this situation is being looked at, and as government has more will come out. Now, as this was going on, Reuters came out with another story, and this story tells you that another bunch of Chinese hacking groups, again close to Chinese security agencies, they tried to hack into the computers of Bharat Biotech and Serum Institute of India, the two companies making the COVID vaccines right now in India, which have been approved for use in India, Covaxin, which is Bharat Biotech, and Covishield, which is Serum Institute of India. And by the way, because I mentioned vaccines, I must say so that, you know, we, my wife and I, also took our shots today. I know the next question will be, how are you feeling? So you figure out how am I feeling. I am recording this within an hour of taking my shot. So if you are already qualified for the shot, please go ahead and take it. If you are too young for it, as most of you might be, then please make sure that you persuade your parents, grandparents, others who are in this category of 60 plus, or people who have serious comorbidities at the age of 45 plus, please go and take your shots. This is our only answer to coronavirus, and this is as safe as any other vaccination. Nevertheless, let me not get distracted. So the Reuters report is based on the research done by another cybersecurity firm based in Singapore and Tokyo. It's called Cy Pharma, C-Y, Cy for Cyber, Pharma, F-I-R-M-A. Cy Pharma is headed by a person called Kumar Ritesh. It's an Indian name. Kumar Ritesh, however, is a top cybersecurity expert who had a top cybersecurity job at MI6. The British External Intelligence Agency. For simplicity and decluttering, MI6 is the agency to which James Bond and his boss M supposedly belonged. So he was in a very senior position in cybersecurity with MI6. He set up this agency, and that agency has reported that there is a Chinese group, another Chinese hacker group known as APT-10, but also called Stone Panda. So first was Red Echo, this is Stone Panda. So this also has tried to burrow into these Indian companies, these Indian vaccine making companies, because one, there is a big competition in vaccine exports and vaccine production between China and India. And second, it could be industrial espionage also to figure out some scientific data. We don't know about that. They also say that Cy Pharma also informed CERT-IN. And CERT-IN, that is the Indian Cyber Computer Security Agency, Computer Emergency Response Team, they acknowledged the information that they released from Cy Pharma. Now, in 2018, US State Department had named APT-10 or Stone Panda as an organization connected with the Chinese Ministry of State Security, which works with PLA. Similarly, Microsoft has also reported some hack attempts by Chinese groups, and many other Chinese groups have come up. There is something, I told you Red Echo, I told you Stone Panda, there is also Tonto Team, whatever that means. So this has caused concern in India, and this has made the role of some organizations that we know very little about. I told you about CERT-IN, Computer Emergency Response Team India. There is also something called National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center, NCIIPC, because these organizations now have a crucial role. Because remember, security threats, warfare between big nations are no longer the domain only of the uniformed armed forces. Today, cyber warriors, at very little risk to themselves, physically at almost no risk to themselves, can cause a bigger havoc than the rest. So that is why the new determinant of national power will not just be how many tanks you have, how many fighter planes do you have, how much megatonnage of nuclear weapons do you have, how many submarines do you have. All that's important, but what will also be important is how good are you behind that screen. So just as they say, man behind the machine matters, man behind the gun matters, or woman today, because you know armed forces have men and women, and the area of cyber sciences have a lot of women. So let me not just use that expression, men. So the power of a country, or gross national power of a country, will no longer be determined by its economy and its military. Your technological ability and your technological vigilance also will be crucial.